back. So there was a lot of confusion going on right now. I'm in Brookfield, Massachusetts, and today they are having an Easter parade. There was large, loud engines going by. And I think that's funny because I did a gel print with Lisa at the Blackstone Valley Art Association, and I was talking about the Uxbridge Fire sirens. And here today we had a parade. So excuse the delay, but I'm back. I wanted to tell you about my palette. I'm not going to hold my palette today because even though it comes natural for me, it seems to be a distraction on the camera. So I'm going to have my palette down, but I'm going to ask Claudia to post a picture of my palette so that you can see it. And then I'll talk about my mediums. I'm using it's a terpenoid-like medium. It's similar to Gamisol. I use that to clean my brushes. I like to recycle. So I have this yogurt jar. And in the bottom, I put the cleaner. Inside the glass here, it's a double-sided glass. And I have walnut oil and Gamisol. I'm going to use a series of brushes. I'm going to say five. I'm going to do five because we're going to do a background. So I'm going to use five brushes. I'll show you. Not sure you can see that. I'm going to start with the largest brush and work myself down to the smallest detail brush. I'm going to use a palette knife. And what I hope to do is finish painting this daffodil. Today, this is the daffodil. I have her modeling. I think of my flowers as dancers. They have to do something to catch me, to dance, you know? So I was talking about the papers here. I don't like to paint flowers so free-handed. Some of them can be very detailed. So I practiced my drawing of daffodils. I have different daffodils in the yard. They have different characteristics. So I'm going to leave my drawing up there. That's one of my tips, is to have a pencil line drawing of your subject, which is the daffodil over here on the left, on my left, so it would be your right. So I'm looking at my subject, and I'm going to make sure that her dress is okay. So in other words, when I'm looking at her, I'm going to make sure that the stems are aligned properly, and it's where I want to see the lighting. It might need to move a little to the left or a little bit to the right. So I've got her dressed up and ready to go, and my lighting is a little bit off, but I want my lighting good for you guys. So I'm going to do my best, and I'm going to try to complete this painting today. If I don't get back to it, I can later show you. That was Crystal. Sorry about that. Every now and then my service dog hears something in the yard, and she responds. So I've looked at her, she's ready to go. My canvas is screwed to the back of this board, and it's pretty steady because I put some big clips on the top here to hold it in place. I highly recommend them if you ever see them in the hardware store. It's good to have them around, especially painting out. I could blow away with any of the winds. I like to keep things covered. This canvas here, I'm going to go over my colors, and I told you that my palette, she was going to post my palette. I decided I'm going to put my palette here so that you can see it. If you can't see it, you'll at least know where I'm working. I'm going to start off with some of the resin gel. I'm going to add my white. My white is a little wet, so I might have to move it a bit. Now, I have lemon yellow. You're welcome to use any yellow you want. I decided to go with the lemon yellow. And then definitely some yellow ochre. I still have a little bit of yellow on my knife, but that's okay because they'll just complement one another. It's very little. Some red. And blue. Now I say a darker blue. This is an ultramarine blue, I think. Yeah, this is an ultramarine blue. And my white is technically two whites. I made it. I'm dripping. I made it so it dries faster. I put a medium in it. So I'm going to start by drawing my painting out roughly, and then I'll work on my large brush. I'm going to use my number two, I think. Stand back so you can see. Now my canvas is a very large 16 by 20 for this piece. I would normally prefer 11 by 14, but I've been getting into these 16 by 20s. They're hard to get into galleries, size restrictions. Because I like a 4-inch frame, so that would be quite a piece. So I'm going to think about this for a minute and decide on my composition. I was just saying to you, I'm not so comfortable about this size here. And it will be quite large. So I'm ready, I think, to go now. I'm halfway down the painting. Sorry about my back. I'll spin around. If you guys have any questions, Claudia is here and she's available to answer them. We'll answer almost everything. You can always email us at artistlauracenedella@gmail.com. I'm mixing up my colors right now on the palette so I can use the resin gel, and I'm going to use the walnut oil up on here. So I'll have two piles going. Alright. So I'll get myself settled here. I have a bag underneath my thing with some paper towels and some extra turpentine-ish medium and some larger brushes in case I need them. And we're just about ready. Okay, so I'm uncomfortable with this light. I told Claudia it probably would be. It gives off heat. So we'll see what happens. I'm used to painting outside, and I don't know if you guys remember, but a couple of years ago it was so hot. I think it was like 108 in the sun, and I was just frying away painting. So I'm going to not stain my canvas this time. We talked about that before. This would be like a staining. I'm going to go right to drawing because I have a large model here that I need to say. You guys can paint from this one on the computer and still ask questions because I have it pulled up for me to see it. The one that I posted on my Laura Cenedella Facebook. But I'm gonna paint this model right here, and it's the same flower. It's just slightly moved a bit because it's a couple of days ago. I'm gonna determine where I want to start my picture with a couple of dots here, maybe one over here. I want to decide where I should move over a little bit more. That's why I explained I'm starting with dots, so I don't have a whole lot of paint. So I'm going to start right here, go right to it. I'm going to start with the darker colors in the back, a little blue, some yellow ochre, and a little bit of red. Now I need some sort of a medium. I'm going to start with a real thin gamma saw. And it's too red, if you see that. I'm used to painting on my palette down there. I'm going to just add a little more blue in here. I can always move my paint around now. I have plenty of paint on the canvas. So I don't know if you can see, but underneath the flower, there's a color coming through, and today's lighting is the black in the back. So it's almost like a green, because it's got a yellow film. The petal here looks like a yellow film leaning over the black silk, which, you know, is a Halloween costume. It's a cape. You can use anything for fabrics. Some people collect clothes because of the fabrics. They're just so beautiful, the patterns. So it's nice and dark, because that's the back. You want to start with it in darkest colors into the lightest colors. So there's that petal there. Now I have to think about this petal and how I want to make that slightly larger. I don't know if you guys can see that. It's about an inch in diameter. About an inch. Remember I said I just like to put a little dot where I want it. So this is one of the hardest things I found was painting flowers. But it's a challenge. I do it at least once a month, I think. About. This is a good time of the year. A little spring fever. It's great to have sun. That's what I had on these pictures that I took of the daffodils. I spent hours with my daffodils the other day. I took photographs of all different shapes and sizes, and I was thinking of workshops I would do on daffodils. So this is a little bit on the brown side. See? I don't know if you can see it matches the background there. Pick up a little more blue. Can you guys hear me well? I know I have my back to you. Am I in the way of the camera?
Mm-mm. You're not.
Okay, there's my dot. Okay, so now I'm up to this petal. Pick up some more blue. There we go with the palette. Now this one here goes over the other one. I left it a little bit lighter here. I don't know if you see that. I put a line here. So I went a little bit lighter where it's overlapping. And then fill this in darker. A lot of times people ask me what strokes I'm using. I have had rotator cuff surgery on my right arm, I've lost the feeling of my hand at least 4 or 5 times. So however I can get the paint on there is the strokes that I use. Because movement restricted or whatever. Nothing restricts me. It just is a bump in the road. Terry Garr said that. So, there's my third petal. Now I'm starting to get some sort of composition here, and I'm thinking I should now come back over here and pick up that green. I want to stay with that same dark color, but I want to add a little more blue for that green. Underpainting. I'm underpainting right now. I'm doing the first layer of paint. I did open studio, not necessarily for a class as much as a chance to continue doing what we were doing before. I was just painting with friends at the Blackstone Valley Art Association Gallery in Uxbridge. And now I hope that my friends are coming here to paint with me at my studio. It's a little different. It's kind of hard to get used to the set here.
I didn't want to interrupt you, but the sound is good. Your position is great. And we have Carol Ann, we have Lisa, Rhea, Mary Foley, Marsha, and me.
So now I'm going to start to steal my paint and move it around because I have that ability. I told you in the back here I want it to have a little more blue because somehow there has to be a definition between these things. I'm just, you know, adding blue and that'll give me more of a dark color. Colder in the back, warmer in the front. Every now and then I squint. You can't see me today because I have really long hair. But this eye here is where I squint. I squint to look at my paintings to make sure that I'm getting the gist of it. That's what I call it. Coming down here now, and the painting the petals of a flower is really difficult. I told you I drew several drawings of it to make sure that I had the gist of it. I'm more of an impressionistic artist, I would say. I just picked up a little more of the red and some of the blue. Some red. I'll show you here. I don't know if you can see it clearly, but later on we'll post pictures. I'm going to start my color palette. I use a journal usually to do something like this so I can keep it. I try to remember what products I used when I got some sort of an effect or I dried a certain amount of time or whatever, so I journal it. For your purposes today, I will be doing it on the canvas here that I used the last time. I just put a stain across it and I'm working in my colors. I'm making sort of a black, if you want to call it a black. It's a blue. I'd say blue is the most dominant color. That's where I was working on these leaves here. Stem. It's going to be a good color to start with. I'm going to take that same color, a little bit of Gamasol, and I'm going to start another pile. Pick up some blue, some red, and some yellow ochre. I'm going to get a brown. This is a tan, so I need to put a little more red and a little more blue. So basically, this is yellow ochre, red, and blue, and it makes a nice brown. I don't know if you can see it. I'm going to start another pile. I'm going to mix some yellow ochre to my brown. I'm gonna jump up again. Using the same paint on my brush, I'm gonna just keep adding these colors. This is the lemon yellow. It's gonna just lighten it some little white. I'm gonna jump up again.
Mary Foley said she loves the idea of a color journal.
Yeah, I've been using a color journal for a really long time. I think I learned in high school about that. The paints aren't always the same, but you can almost achieve the same. Okay, so this is really a skin tone now. So I'm going to jump over to the right with my skin tone. And I'm going to add a little more blue. I'm going to develop my grays, my whites. A little white. And a little more blue. I'm going to add white. And there we go, light. I don't think I need a whole lot of colors here. More than this to start. As I get going, you'll see I'm going to change up my colors. I'm going to take some of this gel now, medium, and I'm going to give everybody a little. Got to be careful now because I'm wiping white, so I turn the brush to the side. Okay, so I added a little bit of white to everybody. I'm going to go lighter. Okay, this is almost purple now. I need more of it. So it's blue, red, and yellow ochre, and then more blue. And I jump up to my light brown. Jump up to my tannish brown. Mix in the gel. Jump up to my skin tone, and then my real light skin tone. Okay. I'm going to start with this dark color here. Clean my brush right in the pile. Alright, so I'm back here at this petal here, and like I said, the lighting is making it look like it's tissue paper over sort of a bluish-black color with the lighting that I have right now. So that's a problem. Lighting changes, so you have to, like, marry it. You have to decide, like, at what point will you stay with the lighting. So this is going to be thinning it more, hopefully helping it to dry. Every now and then I go around and I straighten out my lines. I don't know if you notice my lines aren't very straight. I work on them, layer by layer. I'm over here now on this petal. I'm going to look at my drawing. I'm going to see if I have all my petals where they belong. So if you don't know me, I really like glass. I really love this vase. I don't know if you see it, but it's like perfect for daffodils. I'll only have the top of it on the internet, but I can send in a picture later. I love the vase. I added a little more of the mineral spirits. Well, I'm looking at my drawing. I'm deciding my angle. I don't know if you guys can see, it's more of a cranberry color now with the lighting, but that's okay, it doesn't matter. I'm in the darks. That's where my shadows go. Okay, so I'm gonna decide that I need to somehow define this part here, the round part. I'm gonna have to figure out how to define that. Thinking I'm gonna go a little lighter rather than darker. I'm gonna take some of this lighter color here with some yellow ochre. A little more white. So some tan, whitish color. And a little bit of the resin gel. I'm gonna get my circle in there. Now I'm not gonna marry this because there's a lot of detail to this flower. Could change from layer to layer. If I don't get this in here now, I'm not gonna be able to do much later. It needs to dry. I can wipe it off. I don't know if you guys have seen that. But I'm gonna take my little towel here, wrap it around my finger, and I can just like wipe out the inner part of the flower. That'll automatically give it some depth. Switch them around my finger. I have to have something to break it up to define it.
Your niece Carrie just joined us.
Move around the paint. Try to thin it out as much as I can. It's drying now, I can see it. Okay, now I'm going for this petal here. I decided I'm going to make it a little bit bigger. Up here. Need some more paint. I'm dragging. You can hear it. So I'm taking some of the ultramarine blue. Red, some yellow ochre, and some more blue. So if you guys get a chance, check out the Daffodil Garden at Tower Hill, Boylston, Massachusetts. Pretty cool. We did a modeling thing with Lisa Shea. There's pictures online.
Kathy Reardon just joined us. Hi, Kathy. Hi, Carrie.
So I decided to make this bigger. I told you I'm gonna go at that now really fast. Composition-wise, I think it changed quite a bit. My background is gonna be really dark, so I can put that in here to correct it. Switch my brushes. I'm going to use a larger round brush. Some blue, some red, and yellow ochre. And more blue. I need some more blue. So I'm using some of the drying medium with this so that it's quick and I'm going rather thin. I apologize for the scratching and the brush strokes. But I want to get this on so it dries. And I can decide what color I'm going with. Because I'm just about ready to add my colors. I want to make sure I get to the edges. I'm going to do different strokes at different times because that's how I relax my hand. I don't know if you guys noticed that I was holding my brush totally different. I need to stretch and exercise and stand up and move around. I'm hoping to be able to walk and talk. I like to stand up and paint. Today I'm sitting on a stool, a wooden stool. I can adapt. I like to paint on the rocks. I paint on the side of the river.
The comments are your brush strokes sound like ocean waves, and it's meditative.
Mm, that's good.
Hi, Al. Thanks for joining us.
Can you guys hear Claudia in the background? I heard today that we have a delay. I don't know how many seconds of a delay it is. But see, you can see all my brush strokes right now. I'm purposely doing it.
Al says hello.
Eventually, after layering tons of brush strokes, it will start to create a texture, sort of velvety or silky. You can do different textures. So I'm going to have to get some more paint and rest my arm while I'm doing that. Let me just get from corner to corner. At least part of it will be done. So I've decided on my composition for those of you that came in late. I wasn't quite sure how big I wanted to make it because I do want to focus on the vase here. I really like it. I'm into the glass. This has got a really nice dark green. I'll back up too so that you guys can see this. When I back up, I can do my paints and you guys can have a minute. So my strokes are going down. I want to make sure that they're all going the direction of the fabric. So it doesn't really matter if they're going at an angle or not, but somewhat direct them down. Later on, I won't stop in the middle here because it'll show. I'll smooth it down. Right now, I have that ability to go any direction because I know that I'm putting more paint on there. So I'm working it into the canvas. They have these little tiny cotton ducks, and you know, some people will pounce it, you know, with a rag. You can do that. I'll show you how that's done. I have paper towels here. I told you I know that they're hard to come by these days, but otherwise, you would take a paper towel and you would just pounce it on the canvas. That would fill in the little ducks. I don't know if you can see it here where it's thinner, but there are these little tiny ducks in there. I'm going to fill it all in. This was the staining process that I did last time, where I just like wiped it in, and it gets in all those little crevices. You don't want a section of that to not be covered. You don't want it to be spotty, I guess, unless it meets your painting requirements.
Luke's on. Hey, Luke.
Okay, so I need to fill up with some paint. I'm going to have a second to look at the composition. Is this beautiful model over here? It's a daffodil from my garden. I'm going to load my palette from behind so that I don't get in your way. I don't know if you guys can see the back of my head.
Nope.
I spent a couple of days drawing the picture that I posted. I wanted to make sure that I remembered what a daffodil really looked like. So I guess it was like a study. I took a bunch of photographs. I take them in all different positions and different growth stages. So I suppose I study subjects. I don't necessarily go to a library all the time, but I do always Google it or, you know, look it up. Daffodils. I mentioned earlier that the Blackstone Valley Art Association has a daffodil event every year. They do painting and photography in Boylston, Massachusetts. It's pretty cool. Last year we had a model. I painted her like an old Italian painter that I saw. I sort of tweaked it a bit, but I painted Lisa in the daffodils. They have a field of daffodils. It's beautiful. It goes on forever. I'm working on my field. It's rather small at the time. I have about 4 gardens with daffodils right now in the yard. So I can see here from the camera that this is a little purpley. That's okay because that's my underpainting. It's my blacks. And now I need to fill in this area here, but I want to come back over here. I stopped here where the greens would go. And I can add some yellow ochre. I have to replenish my palette here. I need some blue here. Some yellow ochre. I have plenty on red, but I'll do it just for kicks and giggles. There's some red. I use very little at one time. I don't know if it's the cost or just I'm afraid to lose it. I spill my paint a lot. I just wipe the dirt out of it and forge on. I mix my whites. I use a titanium white with a painter's white, and I use a little bit of the additive to it.
Can you explain the yellow ochre a little bit?
This here?
Yep.
It's one of the basic colors in painting. It's sort of a greenish yellow.
So it's not like a straight yellow?
No, it's more gold, golden.
More of a golden?
Has some blue in it.
Oh, okay. But somebody mentioned it, so.
If you take some of the blue, just the tip of your brush, I have a large brush, well, not a real large brush, but a fairly large brush right now. A little bit of blue, a little bit of red, and I don't want to go into that, I'll use the palette knife. A little bit of yellow ochre. Some blue and red, and a little bit of that resin gel. And I have a blackish color. It's more on the blue side. And I think if you use a lemon yellow, it turns out too green. That's why I use the yellow ochre. I use like a cadmium type red. I don't remember the name on this one. I think it's crimson. I don't know. It's a bright red. Bright red, a dark ultramarine blue.
Oh, you can see.
Bright red and yellow ochre. More blue. lots of black. It's a nice color.
Very pretty.
So if I did it with the other colors, I'll show you. I'll do it on my palette, yellow, red, and blue, and yellow. It's more brown than the yellow ochre already has some blue in it. See, it's darker. I don't know if you can see what I see, but trust me, it's darker. It's a nice, unnatural black, if lack for a better word. It's an unnatural, but it's natural when it goes on the canvas. For instance, if I were to do the stem here, it has a green undertone to it. So when I paint over this.
May I ask a question? Start darker before you then on the, is that the petals that you're working on?
Yeah.
So you start darker and then you lighten it by layers?
Yeah. Exactly.
Thank you.
So I'm starting with the darker colors and letting that dry so that I can add the color. And I'm getting my stems in there. Now down in here, you can't really see my stems like you can see them up here. But that doesn't matter. I'm just painting it in because I'm trying to figure out my composition here. I'm going with my composition as I go. People sometimes will think out their paintings and draw out their paintings and practice their paintings and practice their paintings. And I'm lucky if I get a painting done in that same day. Sometimes it's really hard for me to go back to a painting because I've already started another painting. Or I have another painting in my head or I don't have the time. I like the little curve over here. I don't know if you guys can see it, but it comes up and around and down. So I'm going to go up, around, and down. See, now that's a nice dark background color. And it has a little curve around in here. I have to exaggerate it so that the audience can see it. Now this is where I run into trouble because I changed the drawing. So I'm going to have to come back to my blues and darken my background. I'll switch to the bigger brush. Some blues in here. Thin it out. Every time I put my brush in paint, I put it in thinner. And I usually wipe it. So I don't get the whole dip, I guess you'd call it a dip, when I dip it into the jar. Again, I like to recycle. I use glass jars. I collect glass jars. I like glass, I mentioned before, kind of into glass. So the cuter the glass, the better, but as long as it's recyclable. I very seldom will have to buy things unless I'm going somewhere and I can't transport it, then I'll have to purchase it when I get there. But for instance, if I go places with my family, there's too many bags in the car. I'll have to find the nearest art store when we land. I literally paint every day. I don't always paint well, I just paint for therapy. It's mental and physical. Again, I move my paint around the whole time. I know it's kind of untraditional, but it thins it out if I keep moving it and keep adding to my colors. This is my dark black color, we called it. Darkest color. It's almost purple. See, now I'm almost to my stems. While we're doing this, this part here has dried, from this line over has dried, so that's sort of what I'm doing now to achieve that. I know that I'm timed, but I'm not restricting myself to finish it, but I would like to finish it so that you can see it, or get as close as I can to where I would accept it as a finished piece. Or a piece that people can see. I don't always let people see my art. Sometimes I have to throw it away. It's just so bad it's not for the public. Because I work things out. I mean, I learn all the time. I learn new things. I practice, practice, practice. So I added more medium, more red, some yellow ochre, and some of the resin gel.
London Nelson and Joby has joined us.
Moving my paint around still.
Welcome, ladies.
So it's getting mixed up. Claudia's on the computer if you guys have any questions or comments. I don't know if you can hear her, but she keeps welcoming everyone.
They can hear me.
So I'm back to my darks. I'm trying to move them around and fill in the background. This is my model over here. I love her dress here. It looks like a dress. She's like dancing in the theater. I don't know, ballroom. I don't think that I've ever taken a picture of a flower that it didn't look like it was dancing. I think that's why artists, you know, paint flowers like they're dancers. There's also these flowers, orchids, that look like dancers. But I picked the daffodil because that's like one of those like first field trips that we take, even to the yard. I clean out around my daffodil beds. So that's when I start to prepare my gardens for the season. I need reminders from time to time what time it is, because I can get really carried away.
Engrossed.
I'm trying not to do too much detail to just get my point across. That's one of the things over the painting that I spend, I don't know, maybe more time figuring out how long is it going to take me to get my point across in the painting than it is to do the painting. Because at the end, I just pull it all together.
You're almost an hour in.
I'm going to have to take a break today at some point. So I'm mixing my paint right here on the canvas, rather thin. I just keep adding some of the blue, red, yellow ochre, and resin gel. And then I have to give it more blue to get that dark color. I don't know if you can see, but it's starting to fill in the ducts because I went thicker on the paint. And unfortunately, I have to thin it out, but I just want you to see it. It looks really rich. with the resin gel. That's why I chose that medium. There's silk like material in the background.
Mary just joined us. Hi, Mary.
Oh.
Your niece.
This is very dry over here. So I can come back with some of the resin gel. I had done that with the mineral spirits, gamasol, or turpentine. I don't like the turpentine. I don't use it, especially in the studio. Unless I have to. Like, if I have to go to a hardware store, I'm thinking, if I can't get art supplies, I'm going to have to go to a hardware store. And I'm fortunate that they're still open. I can use hardware store supplies, but I prefer artist supplies. They make a world of difference. I don't know if you guys can see, but like, if I were using household oils right now, it would be very, very thick. This is more of a stain. I would have to use a lot of turpentine if it was household paint, but it's possible. I can't give you the exact recipe to what I do, but I make up a solution that helps it dry fast. So when I go out, I spend anywhere from an hour to 6 hours out painting. The 6 hours is really a lunch break and a couple of bathroom breaks, and I walk around and walk around and walk around. Walk the dog. 3 hours is probably about an hour and 45 minutes because I take a break again. It's kind of hard when I'm painting on this angle. So I've painted on my lap many times. It just depends on where I'm at and how I'm doing. I have all kinds of tools for painting. As I said, I had shoulder surgery and I had to use adaptive equipment to continue painting, and I did, because I'm used to painting all the time. It's sort of a therapy. It helps me stop and think and breathe. I enjoy my environment. Just paying attention to this beautiful species over here. And this wonderful dress of a vase. It's very therapeutic. I mean, it looks to me like a real thin paper, sort of like a tissue paper. It's reflecting sort of a blackish, bluish, purple background. I see some red in it. I see a lot of greens and blues in the petals behind them. And that's where I'm at now. I'm behind all that. And I'm trying to get some paint on the canvas. I'm going to finish this one corner and then I'm going to take a break. I recommend that you all do that too. If you're painting alongside me, I would love to see your pictures. You could either send them to Lisa at the Blackstone Valley Art Association and she'll post them. Or you can email them to me and ask that they not be shown. You can put them on the comment section right now if you know you're stuck on something or you want somebody's input. There's a lot of people here and there's a lot of painters here. If you needed somebody's input, there's people there. How many people do we have watching?
Seven.
Seven people. I'll guarantee you that there is an artist in the group.
More than one. Luke says it looks awful on the arm, and he said his arm is sore just watching it.
Really? It's the price that I pay for beauty. I don't know, I have pretty good arms. I work out, I paint every day. Sometimes, you know, it's raining or whatever, I might need an ibuprofen or something. Some anti-inflammatory. I eat them. Now I'm scratching it like I'm working it into the ducts. Because if I leave white spots behind, my next layer is not going to take the same. So I want to make sure, like I said, if I wanted to use a paper towel, I could, but I prefer the digging into the canvas. No, I'm not really digging in. It just sounds like it. It's very scratchy. I'm using some red and some more medium. My brush is kind of dry, and when the scratching gets harder, it's sort of a reminder for me to add medium. My friend Muriel always tells me, make sure you get all the edges. She's a member of the Art Association from, I think, the beginning.
So Marsha just got her order today, so she's giving it a try. And Linda Nelson said that she loves the background for the daffodil. And Luke's not sure if you can post photos or not.
Oh, are you painting a line on the computer?
Flower wisdom from Deborah Walker. We dance and don't care who's watching us. Try it sometime.
Yep.
I like that.
Beautiful. So I'm leaning towards a break, but I'm trying to get the canvas covered. Again, I'm using the ultramarine blue. We're going to call it a crimson red, yellow ochre, and some of the resin gel. But I have some Gamisol on my brush. Paint my edges. I hold my brush in different positions for different strokes, but I also hold it for exercise. Like I said, you know, I told you don't stay too long in one position and don't repeat the same patterns over and over again. I learned that from my rotator cuff surgery, unfortunately. I was probably painting too much at the time, or all in the wrong position. So my stems are going to be going in here on my vase. So I gotta be very careful not to go with the dark, dark. And the vase here, it's almost a black. So when I get closer here, I think I should go a little bit lighter, more on the green side. Do you see the light green in the middle of the vase? I'm gonna pick up some of the light yellow. I got lemon, it's called. And I'm gonna put that lemon black color in the middle here so I don't lose where I'm headed. This is where I say sometimes I have to go light, dark, light, dark. This is one of those times. And I'm going to go thinner with the mineral spirits. Like I said, I don't have a recipe for this. I have to work my way through it. And this is where I'm at. I'm subtracting some of the color here to lighten it so that I don't lose my area here. Same time, I don't want to really throw away the paint, so I can move it around. It's thin enough, because I've been thinning it. I don't want it to crackle. If you use too much of the thinners, you could crackle. And it could not, if you use too little, it could do something. So you want to like learn what your tolerance for mediums, they smell. There's not really, they call it odorless mineral spirits, but it's not real odorless. It's less odor. Now I'm working in my colors I was talking about earlier by just subtracting. I know that this is going to be lighter in this area, so I can subtract it. And I don't want to make it too thin that it crackles, so I can move it around. And the odor is, I don't know, on a scale from 1 to 10, it's about a 6. So there it is. I worked out my composition. I covered my canvas. I'm going to take a little bit of a break right now and stretch. It's important to get up and stretch. This also gives it some time to dry. So I'm drinking ginger ale or ginger beer. Sorry for carbonation if it comes out. I try not to get really serious, but when it comes to painting, I'm very serious. Okay, so I was sort of thinning this area out, and I see that it's still wet enough that I can keep working at it. It seems kind of tedious, but you'll see why I'm doing this later. I have a bag under my easel here for trash. Very important to keep that nearby because I separate my trash when I do this. I have to go right out with my trash. Goes into a metal container.
Dennis joined us, says hello. Hi Dennis, it's Claudia. Nice to see you.
So I just added a little more blue here now so I can see this clearer because my background is a purple color, sort of like a between a burgundy and a plum. And I can always go light if I have trouble seeing it. The stem in here is very light. So if I added a little bit of the yellow ochre, I can get that definition too. In my vase. Again, I'm trying to go with the direction of everything. I don't know if I'll finish it, but I'll at least have a beginning here and be able to tell some sort of a story. I think of my paintings sometimes as like a story. So how do you want to see her? You want to see her standing there and tall and strong, and daffodils are a good sign of the beginning of a wonderful season. I think that's why people flock to the botanical garden to see the daffodils, because they've been shut in all winter long and they're dying to see some beauty. Sort of use my brushes like calligraphy sometimes. I turn to get a movement. I don't know if you can see that. I'll try to do it light so you can see it. So let me find a light area down here. I turn my brush with my arm and then I turn the brush. See? So when I do that, I get the shape that I want. It took me a while to learn all these moves. It's not like something I did overnight. I probably painted about 300 kids every summer, face painting. Lots of practice in painting from pictures. I looked at the pictures and painted the face. So yeah, that's a gig that I had, face painting. I did it for nonprofit organizations for a fundraiser. It gave me a lot of practice. So I don't know if you can see how I turn my wrist. Some things I've learned just by doing it. I highly recommend that people that are afraid of painting with oils, just do it. You will learn it eventually. I mean, practice, practice, practice. So in here it comes down and around. I almost lost that. There we go. Underneath this vase is really dark, which it would be no matter what colors I went with. So I'm just going to put some blues in here. Again, my paint is not dry. Oil paintings don't really dry for about a year. I mean, they'll dry to some extent, but I wouldn't varnish it for a year. Unless you have a varnish mixture as a drying medium. But, they dry enough to add more, if you can understand that. I can now mix in other colors. The yellow actually shows up. If I continue to go in this area that's wet, I've got to find one that's wet, it's just going to keep making mud. And that's the practice that you need, to not make mud. You just have to keep working with your colors so that you don't make mud, and eventually you will get it. I always say start with a small amount of paint. You know, I started my palette when I was working this out. I started my palette with a small amount of paint, and I'll determine how much paint I think I'm going to use. And I'll put that down and come back at it from time to time. Sometimes I change the paints midstream. If the color's not working, it's not working. You know, you'll know that as you go along. But it's all underpainting at this point. We're changing it up a little bit just so that it fits on my canvas. This is a 16 by 20. I would have it vertical. I'm using oil paints. animal spirits for cleaning with a little bit of resin gel. I like the glossy gel mediums. I have used the matte before. I can't wait to varnish them. I like the glossy effects. I think that's why I do oils, is you can change the effects. I know you can with watercolor too, but it's a little harder to paint dark. I'm pretty dark, in general. Again, I'm just working in my colors where I can, depending on my drying time. I don't need as much of the drying medium the thicker I go. So now I'm going to bring in some more stem so I don't lose it. Start here. I added some of the lemon yellow to the blue. I'm going to go real light here because I'm going to start to put my stems in. It's almost a gray green. I love the daffodil green. Daffodil green. There's a daffodil green, sort of a sappy light green. That's why I use a little bit of the lemon, also for the petals. Yeah. Different. So this is two greens, three greens, four greens, I don't know. So this is a gray green and this is more of a yellow green. And then I really have to define them because I have so many greens. And like I said, I don't know, because I'm just going to keep going at it. Just going to keep copying what I see. I'm working on different areas. It needs a little more yellow. The light really hits it down below. I'm looking for shapes. It's sort of a square-like shape down in here. With my daffodil stems. You don't always see things what they really are. They're shapes. Look for shapes. I do this thing where I practice shapes sometimes. I do triangle, circle, oval. Then make it 3D, make it a box and a cone, and practice, practice, practice. Then I can see things, I hope to see things better. So my stems kind of like go out and they're a little bit lighter on the one side than they are the other. So I'm just going to say it's white now because I don't want to lose it. It's a white foam green like color, almost a nautical green. You'll see later on when I get my vase work done, it'll start to show up better. Again, this is like a square down here. Square area. The light seems to be coming in. The front there. I want to stand up and look. I don't want to put too much of the yellow. Just enough to define it. Just a hint of the yellow. And a little bit of light. Start adding some of my other stems. I'm mixing the white and some lemon and some blue, like a light green. And again, I pick up my additives, my drying mediums, every time I put my brush down. And I hope that it'll dry enough that I can keep adhering paint to it. I call it sticking. It's sticking. I don't like to use a lot of the white. I'd rather subtract. The white doesn't dry very fast. I'm going to subtract up here a bit. I don't have any more blues up here. Okay, so I'm going to mix some blue, some of the gel, some red. Some lemon yellow. I might need to stand back from time to time and see what I'm doing. Okay, I'm going to stand back now. Take a deep breath. See where I'm going. Where I've been. And what's next? Those are the questions I ask myself. Okay. Let's see. Where are we at?
It's almost 2:25. No new questions. Looking good.
How many people do we have?
Seven.
Is there anybody painting with me?
I believe Marsha is or was.
Okay, so in here I'm going to have to subtract. It's kind of dark. The paint is still, technically it's dry. I mean, to the touch, it's dry. But I can subtract it. And try to subtract it here. It has a great little curve here. I want to make sure I get.
Linda Nelson just checked in and said hi. Hey, Linda.
It's So we're coming close to the end. I want to get into my yellows. We'll talk about my yellows, at least. Let's try to get the shape here a little more together. Some light here.
Jackie Cole just joined us. Hi, Jackie.
So I'm just correcting an area with the background color, because I know I have to go over the background anyway. I told you I fix my lines as I go. That's what I'm doing now, fixing the line. So I want to lighten this area here so you can see it with the dark background. I'm going to give you the gist of it so I can tell my story before I go. I'm going to switch brushes to save on cleaning time. Larger brush. Let's move around and get some paint. I put very little paint on my palette at a time. I should probably put more, but it's a waste. If I don't get back to this for a while, I will not waste too much. Grab a drink. Stretch. Now, we don't have a whole lot of time, but I want to make sure that I get my story out, I said. So, I have the gist of the vase. Throw in some of that background so that you can see the yellow when it pops. I'm going to use some of the blue, red, the yellow ochre, and some more blue. And I'm going to use some of that gel, medium. Wet my brush. So see, it's sort of wiping away at some places. My brush might have too hard of bristles, so I just need more paint. Too much vitamin. Gotta go thicker. It was starting to take over here a little bit easier. So more paint, more blue, red, and yellow ochre. I need to get that to take. There we go. Now it's taking. Needs a little more blue. I'm gonna go right up to the vase and make sure it's not green. So when you're using all these colors, the colors can lean towards a color. This is leaning towards a purple. So that would be more on the reddish blue. It's cooler in the back and warmer in the front. I'm gonna give it some depth. So I wanna make it really the blue in this area here. And add the blue directly. Get a thin line of it. I'm squinting my eye at it to try to find where I'm going. I'm pulling the paint away from the edges. Make sure it's nice and smooth. Remember I told you at some point my lines are going to have to be blended in. Here's one of those places. This is where the glass is. So I want my direction to go down. I was just pulling out so I made sure I didn't get too close to the glass. I'm mixing it in and blending it as I go. It's starting to stick. I may have wanted to start with an even stronger solution, but see, now the glass is starting to come forward a little bit more. I'm going to work on this leaf here. Blend it in. The heat in here. The heat in here. It's something.
I can turn it down for you.
This lamp gives off a lot of light, a lot of heat besides light. I'm gonna stand back anyway and look at this. Make sure my greens are different. Okay. I don't know if you can see the petals on this are sort of a yellow green because it's got a black background on the image that I posted. It has sort of the same look. It's got better lighting than I have here now. I'm going to say it's a greenish, yellowish, pale color in these two back petals. I'm going to build that color now using some of the lemon. That's why I switched to the lemon I told you for my upper color. I'm raising my colors as I go. Okay. So on here, I would take the lemon, a little bit of the red, some white. There's one color. And then I go lighter, more white. Oops. More white. Now I want to introduce a greenish color. I'm going to get some more blue and mix it with my yellow. It needs more yellow now. There's this color in the background. It's sort of a gray. I have extra paint on my brush. Okay, so here's my first petal. I'm putting in some of this green color here. Wherever I see it. Now I'm going to go back to my lighter yellow here. Whenever I put anything down and I come to another color, it's going to blend with it. So. Think of that. Just go a little bit lighter. Kind of dark back in here, but there is some lighting. Have to give it. Sometimes you have to give it some lighting if it's warranted. You don't technically see it. Doesn't mean it's not there. You know that the light's coming in from this direction. Okay, here it's really pale. I'm going to drag some of that white through here. And then here, it's orange-ish. Orange-ish. So I take some of the yellow and the red like I did before. Very little of the red. The red goes a really long way. The yellow ochre would be fine, but it's too much on the blue end, the blue spectrum for me. The center here. Goes around. And it's almost red. It's so orange-ish. Orange-ish. I make up my own color sometimes. So I'm going to do a little more red and some of the yellow. Those little ripples in there. The Chris shapes. This is a triangle here, a little triangle. Helps it to look more realistic, impressionistic, realistic, really. Okay, so now I'm going into the real pale yellows again. Trying to find where they go. Looking for shapes all the time. Painting shapes. Strokes. Strokes and shapes are almost the same thing. Or you make it the same thing, make it your own. Okay, so it's sort of green down in here, I think. More of a greenish yellow. In here. But I don't want to lose the yellow, so. Find some yellow. And here is yellow orange. And a light yellow orange. A light yellow orange in here. Almost white up here. I almost want to hit this with a little bit of the dark, see what happens. I see sort of like a darkish color in here. More blue. I got enough blue here to go around. I'll work it around. And here. Switch brushes again. Now I'm getting them into the smaller parts. I was hoping this area would be more dry, but we'll work with it.
Lisa said that she thinks it's amazing how it develops. She talked about time lapse for this one. And before medieval English knew of the fruit, orange, they had no special word for that color since it was rare, and they just called it red yellow.
Red yellow?
Yep.
That's my color.
It's interesting.
So I'm getting to the end of this, and I'm going to just give you the gist of this and continue this another time. My more detailed paintings take like 6 hours, so this is pretty fast. I've spent months on paintings. People always say, how long does it take? Years. Practice, practice, practice.
Lisa had a good point that people can sign up for your class for the full experience.
So what time is it?
You got about 10 minutes.
Okay. Any questions, anyone, before we hang up?
Questions, comments? Nothing yet. Lisa made a comment. Had she not been watching what you were doing, she would have started out with the yellow right from the beginning.
Dark to light. For oil paintings, you start with dark to light. I have done it back the other way, but you want to do it the way they say it's your piece, you do it any way you want. But dark to light works out better. So I'll just keep going until we can't.
Marsha said it's not easy and she needs a little more practice.
Keep working until Claudia shuts this off, but remember, you can get a hold of me. I don't mind talking to you online or by email if I have time.
Deborah Walker said this was great. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you for coming, you guys.
Yes, thank you all for coming. Anything else before we go?
There you go. Thank you. It was fun. Have a great
day.
Take
care of everybody, and happy Easter.
For those of you that celebrate.
Yep.